What connotations does the word cancellation bring to you? Is it something negative? Or maybe positive after all? Or perhaps the interaction of the two? To illustrate the role of cancellation, let us start with a little computational exercise. Let us try to estimate the amount of electric charge in the atmosphere here at the Marcio States. Science informs us that the air consists mainly of nitrogen and oxygen, with smaller amounts of other gases. And furthermore, we recall, maybe from high school, that in the atoms, in the nucleus, there are protons and neutrons. The protons carry a positive elementary charge each. Neutrons are without any charge, and the electrons on the orbits have a negative elementary charge each. Okay. So here is a sample of air that I collected about here. And now, to estimate the total charge, we could start off by counting the positive ones. So we throw away the orbits and just look at the nuclei. And in this sample, we arrive at plus 72 elementary charges. To extrapolate this result to the whole room, I could ask each of you to count the protons nearest to you. But in the interest of time, I did this exercise in advance, and I came up with the following number. Depending on your preferred system of naming very large numbers, it's either 600 octillion or 600 quadrilliard elementary charges, an absurdly large number. Okay, but we still have the negative charges to take into account. Okay, so now we throw away the nuclei, just look at the electrons on the orbits, and we arrive at exactly the same numbers, but with a minus sign. And adding up, we can conclude with a perhaps boring but physiologically safer result of neutral total charge at Marcio States. Maybe some of you realized it before, at least now we could have arrived at the same conclusion in a much easier way by just realizing the neutral charge of each atom to begin with without ever making the intermediate step of the absurdly large numbers. So this is the role of cancellation in a particular instance. Now in mathematics, we are not really interested about individual numbers most of the time, but rather about general principles by which we come up with such numbers. And some objects of study are functions, which are rules which relate one number to another number, and a little bit on the next level of abstraction, transforms, which relate one function to a new function. So some examples, maybe from high school, you remember the sine function, which for the number 45 degrees produces the results of 1 over square root of 2. And an example of a transform named after the German mathematician David Hilbert takes as an input the sine function and produces another trigonometric function, the cosine. Now, also in the study of functions, it is often of relevance to understand what are the related atoms, the elementary components of vanishing charge. And likewise, one can pose the same question for the transforms. Now, in the case of functions, a notion that has turned out to be quite useful is defined as follows. So just like a physical atom, we demand a neutral charge. In mathematical sense, it means the average zero of positive and negative values. You see two examples of this in the bottom. And also, a little bit like the physical atom, but maybe a little bit more liberally in mathematics, we require some kind of constrained size in the same sense of height times width. So a more spread out atom has to be smaller in height and vice versa. Now, what about the transforms? In this case, there is not really one right answer. The right answer will depend on the context. But An answer that has turned out to be surprisingly useful for many purposes is something that I discovered about 14 years ago. It identifies the atoms of transforms as so-called dyadic shifts. Since the formulas on this slide are pretty self-explanatory, I will not go into further details with them, but this is just to give you a feeling of things that we do in advanced mathematics. Now, in the remainder of my talk, I would like to discuss cancellation in yet another meaning, not as an object of study, but as a way of thinking. David Hilbert, the inventor of the Hilbert transform, was active not only in research, but also outreach. And in the year 1930, he made a podcast of the time about the role of mathematics as the fundamental instrument of both scientific and industrial innovation. He concluded with the slogan, "Wir wollen wissen, wir werden wissen." We want to know and we shall know. And today, of course, both the amount and availability of information has exploded compared to Hilbert's time. And his slogan has become everyday usage of us under the abbreviation www. And this brings us to the new challenge of the century, how to best handle all the information that we keep collecting. One of the oldest metaphors for the accumulating knowledge of mankind is the Tower of Babel or Babylon described in the Genesis. Layer upon layer of bricks reaching ever higher towards the skies. This can be an inspiring image, but it also comes with a dark side, because every aspiring scholar will still start their journey from the ground floor. So how then will they stand a chance of reaching the top and joining the construction when the top escapes ever higher, even when they are setting their feet on the first steps? And does this mean that there will be a time when another layer can no longer be added, simply because it is not feasible over the human lifespan to climb through all the existing layers, understand the supporting constructions, which is essential for adding yet another stable layer on the top? To fight this pessimistic scenario, I would like to propose another metaphor. A metaphor of my generation of the 1980s, the game of Tetris. In this classic computer game, the player scores for all the bricks that they manage to fit into the field of play, much like a scholar scores UFO points for every publication that they manage to make. And thus, in the short run, the optimal scenario would seem to be that you just put down as many bricks as you can as fast as possible, wherever you can place them. Well, whoever has played Tetris will realize that this strategy will quickly backfire against the longer-term goals, without paying attention to where the bricks actually fit. You will soon run out of space to add any new ones. And in Tetris, this means game over. In science, it might mean a gradual declining into stagnation and incrementality. So thus, the key to really scoring high in Tetris is not really to add, but to subtract, and to place the bricks in such a way that they do not just pile up, but they fit into the place where they actually remove some existing layers, producing new space, new room for new opportunities. And the thesis I would like to make is that the game of science should be played in the same way. by seeing where the new pieces of information best fit, thereby creating new room, new space for new opportunities. The English mathematician Hardy, in his 1940 essay, A Mathematician's Apology, wrote the following. The mathematician's patterns, like the painter's or the poet's, must be beautiful. The ideas, like the colors or the words, must fit together in a harmonious way. Beauty is the first test. There is no permanent place in the world for ugly mathematics. For a layman, beauty as an attribute to mathematics may well seem alien. If you imagine page after page of long and technical computations, you might very legitimately wonder, would a mathematician call that beautiful? And let me make a disclosure. Most of them wouldn't. A mathematician, too, dislikes unnecessary complications. A long and technical computation might well be needed, accepted, because it serves a purpose at the point of time, but it is unlikely to survive a test of time. And it is precisely for this reason of contrast that the brilliant, clear idea that makes one avoid such ugliness often merits the attribute of beauty. Of my own academic accomplishments, the dyadic representation theorem, the atomic theory of mathematical transforms, one could say, that I hinted at in one of the previous slides, attempts to contribute to this ideal. It was not the first result of its kind, but it reached a certain completeness by avoiding, cancelling out unnecessary assumptions of several previous contributions. The moment that one achieves something like this in the game of science is comparable to hitting the long Tetris block at exactly the right spot. We call it a breakthrough when we break through the wall of the established and meritorious but incomplete theory that blocked our sight from seeing the wider horizons. That is the perfect cancellation. Thank you.